Today we're talking about question answering. But before we get into the details about how, say, a particular computer algorithm works to allow it to answer questions, I want to start with a big picture question. Why do we have computers answering questions in the first place? And the way that I'd like to motivate this discussion is contrasting Cranfield and Manchester. That may sound like a National League football matchup, but it's a distinction that I think helps us understand why people and computers try to answer questions. Even though many people do question answering research, they're trying to get machines to answer questions, they often do so for different reasons. In this video, I want to outline a thesis developed by Pedro Rodriguez, a former student of mine, that categorizes the two major schools of thought for question answering and why I think this distinction is important. So first, let's start off with the Cranfield paradigm of question answering. It takes its name from Cranfield University in Bedfordshire. This university is unique for having its own airport. It was part of the revolution in how information retrieval is evaluated. To quote Ellen Vorhees, in the Cranfield paradigm, researchers perform experiments on test collections to compare the relative effectiveness of different retrieval approaches. In the Cranfield paradigm, you create a data set that best approximates what people will look for in a document collection, and the better your algorithm does at satisfying those queries, the better it will do in practice. You can use the same approach to evaluate how well a computer answers questions. It's not surprising that many organizations like Google, which started out as a search engine, if you don't remember, adopted this setting with gusto. In 2019, they published their data set, Natural Questions. To do this, they found a bunch of questions people asked online, found the answers in Wikipedia. You can then evaluate for a new question answering system whether it can go out, find the answers, and highlight them in a way that would serve a user. Under the Cranfield paradigm, a good QA system should answer these questions. Those are, after all, the questions people care about. What more could you want? And that's where the Manchester paradigm comes into play. And it's also time for me to reveal my own bias here. The reason I do question answering is different. Sometimes systems that work well on these data sets are actually pretty dumb. Natural Questions looks like another data set, Squad, where we showed that the system learned stupid word association patterns. For example, if you asked the question did in this context, it would just say Colorado Springs experiments. That is not a good answer to this question. As an alternative to the Cranfield paradigm, we propose the Manchester paradigm. There are a couple reasons to call it the Manchester paradigm. The first reason to call this the Manchester paradigm is a bit of a stretch. I'll level with you. I really wanted to call this paradigm the Sphynx paradigm in the first place. And so I just wanted to find some way to connect it to Manchester, which is the name that we eventually ended up choosing. The Manchester regiment, however, did use the Sphynx as its insignia. In Greek myth, the Sphynx asks questions to anyone who tried to enter the city of Thebes, a riddle. Here's PDQ Bach's interpretation of the riddle. What starts out on four legs, then goes round on two, then finishes on three before it's through? And the answer is, well, a baby, then a man, that's plain, then finally an old geezer on his cane. Now, I won't spoil the whole story, but by answering the question correctly, Oedipus revealed that he was smarter than the average bear, and also unlocked secrets from his own past. In a commencement address to Whitman College, Dana Burgess explained how this is different from the way that Google answers questions, and how that difference relates to the mission of professors like me. Nobody told Oedipus who he was. He figured that out for himself. You can do a Google search to find out the capital of Arkansas, Little Rock, but you can't do a Google search to find out who you are, what you're good at, what makes you happy, what matters for your life. Information retrieval isn't any help with that stuff. When folks say that a college professor is like the Sphinx, they don't usually mean that in a nice way. It suggests that we know the answers students need, but we keep those secret for the sake of our own power. That's part of the riddle of the Sphinx and its hybrid nature. The course of being forced to solve a riddle is the gift of the ability to solve riddles. And at least that's also part of the reason that I want to answer questions, not just to serve users, but to teach machines to answer questions on their own without shortcuts. The second reason to call this introspective, challenging approach to question answering the Manchester paradigm is Granada Studios, which is based in Manchester. This studio created the television program University Challenge, first a bootleg and then a licensed offshoot of Dan Reed's College Bowl. This program pits two universities against each other to see who is smarter. Just like the Sphinx, the person asking the questions, Bamber here, knows the answer. This is not an information-seeking task a la the Cranfield paradigm, where the person asking the question is an uninformed user. It, like the riddle of the Sphinx, is a test of those answering the questions. It's also a tried and true method of question answering researchers to prove their mettle, as when IBM Watson appeared on Jeopardy against the greatest Jeopardy player of all time, Ken Jennings. And Brad Rutter was there too. This makes the goal clearer. While Cranfield focuses on whether users are satisfied, the Manchester paradigm is at its heart an evaluation of question answerers themselves, either systems or humans. Which is smarter? Which is worthy? The final reason to call this the Manchester paradigm is a paper written by Alan Turing while he was at the University of Manchester. Building off of a party game called the Imitation Game, Alan Turing proposed that a skilled interrogator could ask questions to either a machine or a human. If the computer could answer those questions as well as a human, so that the interrogator could not tell which was which, he proposed that this could be a test that could decide whether a computer had achieved artificial intelligence. This competition, the so-called Turing test, has become the holy grail of artificial intelligence. Intelligent machines are also the domain of science fiction, where these tests have taken forms like the Voight-Kampff test in Blade Runner, inspired by the work of Philip K. Dick.
Is this the test now?
Yes. You're in a desert.
These are not information-seeking questions about tortoises.
You look down, you see a tortoise, Leon. You reach down, you flip the tortoise over on its back, Leon.
Similarly, the Winograd Schema Challenge is not actually interested in fitting stuff inside suitcases, but rather, do those questions reveal something about those answering them? There's not a dichotomy between these two approaches, which can sometimes mask how important the distinction is. At the moment, if you're interested in either the Cranfield or Manchester paradigm, there's no reason to prefer a particular methodology. So researchers from both camps can be interested in better retrieval, better machine reading, or what have you. But there's a bigger distinction in the datasets. Some datasets lend themselves naturally to the Cranfield paradigm, such as natural questions. My tilt towards the Manchester paradigm also is revealed in my preference about question answering formats, Quiz Bowl. It's complicated, it's unnatural, but it's the best way given two humans to tell which is better at answering questions. And that same insight can be applied to computers. And the evaluations of what makes for a good answer is also naturally different. Whereas the Manchester paradigm will focus on the odd, long tail of questions, the Cranfield paradigm naturally focuses on the mode. What are people going to ask about most? Can you answer that well? Setting up this distinction helps explain some of the weird conversations that I've had in the past.
Always good to talk to our friends in academia. So, Professor Boyd Graber, do you have any ideas for how to improve question answering?
Let's get some trivia experts to write some questions with super rare syntactic embedding.
Nobody actually asks questions like that. But do you have any idea how to increase our accuracy on questions about 1970s song lyrics? We've seen about a 5% increase on our already high traffic. So that's our number one priority
gotta go.
Right
Somebody
now.
Just released a Code Switch Navajo and Pashto question answering dataset about Australian scientists written by learned league authors. It seems really cool.
Well, he's working on really useless crap. I just don't understand what his priorities are.
Whoa, he's really working on completely useless crap. I just don't understand him. But when it comes to methods, in the last several years, the approaches that excite those from the Cranfield camp also equally excite the Manchester camp. And those who only focus on methods above all else will opportunistically use whatever dataset best shows off their fancy new techniques. In some ways, I think it's like the distinction between Bayesians and frequentists. There's a lot those statisticians can agree on, but on some issues, you're just not going to come to a consensus. While many business dissertations will be written on what happened with IBM Watson's circuitous route from Jeopardy spectacle to a discarded spinoff, and I have no insight as to why it was not as successful as hoped, one aspect that made the transition more difficult was that the tour de force victory on Jeopardy was firmly on the side of the Manchester paradigm. But to be successful commercially, it needed to make the shift to the Cranfield paradigm. Similarly, Squad was written by people who knew the answers, just like most of the questions in the Manchester paradigm. However, it didn't follow the same principles of the Manchester paradigm, which led to the shortcuts that investigators have discovered in the years since. In another paper called What Question Answering Can Learn from Trivia Nerds, we made the argument that you can fix some of these problems by adopting the best practices of the Manchester paradigm, efficiently testing human intelligence in trivia tournaments. However, the paper, I think, would have been a lot better if it could have included this distinction between those two paradigms. Indeed, the paper was probably not as successful as it could have been, falling on deaf ears of those firmly in the Cranfield camp, who only care about datasets whose true distributions match what users do. Similarly, while the Manchester paradigm lends itself to comparisons between systems, the Cranfield paradigm does not. This can lead to misleading or downright false claims of things like computers are better than humans at reading that come as a result when you try to take a Cranfield paradigm question answering task and cast it as a competition. While I feel that the distinction between Cranfield and Manchester is a personal revelation for myself, how should the community deal with this? I have a couple of ideas. First, if you are philosophically in the Cranfield camp, make sure that your metrics simulate what real users would do and react as much as possible. I personally have done some of my own research on this side of the Cranfield fence, trying to measure how well users can understand what question answering systems are doing. This is work with Shurfeng, to allow humans to take the noisy outputs of QA systems and make informed decisions about whether an answer is correct or not. I think that there is also a strategic opportunity for academia and funding agencies. Given the natural inclination of corporations to affiliate with the Cranfield paradigm, and all of the resources that go along with that, universities should focus more on the Manchester paradigm of question answering, and funding should help them do that. The Manchester paradigm also lends itself to public exhibitions. For those working in the Manchester paradigm, think about how your evaluations could be game showified to make question answering more fun and illuminating to the general public. But on a more philosophical level, my hope is that merely by naming these approaches, it might encourage authors of QA datasets and QA algorithms to question why they're doing question answering and align themselves with one of these paradigms. Or alternatively, if you think that my ontology does not fully capture why we do question answering, I would love to hear your own question answering motivations named, preferably, after a British university town. Answering questions for users and understanding the nature of intelligence are both noble goals. For some people, the data don't matter much. They'll work on any data set so long as it lets them do cool machine learning. For them, the distinction is meaningless. However, as scientists, it's important to occasionally have moments of introspection about why we're doing the things that we do. What is the goal we want to achieve? Question answering is no different, and I hope that by articulating these two sides of question answering, we can, as a community, likewise articulate our values both to ourselves and the outside world. Those in the Manchester paradigm should be able to say, I'm creating questions that may or may not be useful, but they are helping better expose whether machines and humans are intelligent, and that's okay. Those in the Cranfield paradigm should be able to say, I'm answering questions that meet real people's information needs, and that's okay too. My hope is that this will also help us bridge the divide more effectively, that those of us on the Manchester side can think about how to create questions that get to the needs of those on the Cranfield side without going overboard. And perhaps those on the Cranfield side can think about metrics that both serve users and also can effectively reveal whether their methods are understanding the underlying text. My suspicion is that this distinction will be a temporary one, and that in some number of decades, the question-answering agents that best serve users will be those with near-human-level intelligence and will need the insights of both Cranfield and Manchester. If you want to see more videos like this, check the video description for the course that comes from the link down below. You can then see the context and the correct order for watching these videos. YouTube will gleefully show you stuff in the wrong order. If you want other people to see this video, provide a big gradient to the recommendation algorithm by clicking the like and subscribe button down below.